Hello, this is Angela Anderson. Welcome. I am doing a live stream show today, and I am going to paint this weeping willow with water reflections on a lake here. I found the image on the web, and I really fell in love with it. I added a little bit more color because it was kind of gray. I've got my husband here helping me today.
Hey, everybody.
And he will take your chat questions. So if you've got any questions for me while I'm painting, you can ask them, and he will get those to me whenever we can fit them in. So really appreciate everybody that showed up today. I was chatting with some of you before the show, and that was a lot of fun. So if you're the first time to my channel, be sure to subscribe so that you can join in with the chat. And after the show, you can click on my picture there, and it will take you to my channel, and you can see some of the other paintings and things that I do. Basically, my channel is about helping beginners learn to paint, making it fun and easy, and giving you paintings that you can achieve even if you're new to painting. So let's get started today. I keep my paints in a little thing here when I set them out early. Keeps them fresh for up to about a week if you spray them every now and then. I've got a very limited palette today. We've got titanium white, black. This is carbon black, but you can use whatever black you've got. Phthalo blue, burnt sienna, and yellow ochre, or yellow oxide, either one. They're both basically the same. Yellow oxide is just transparent. And I did my practice on a Strathmore sketchbook here. It's a mixed media pad. Got a link to one of the ones that I use down in the description if you're interested. I'll give you a sneak peek for next week. Should I show them? Should I show them next week's?
Yeah.
Isn't he cute? I couldn't resist giving him glasses. You don't have to put glasses on him if you don't want to, but we're going to do this next week. I can't wait. He was super fun, and he was really, really fast. So I may even do a second animal if we have time. You know, maybe I have a feeling we'll get him done in an hour. So that'll be next Saturday's show. So be sure to check that out. I'm going to set that aside and start on painting. I've got a 12 by 16 inch canvas here, and I'm just going to spray it down with a little bit of water. That just helps the paint absorb down into the canvas. And I've got a large flat brush. I'm going to wet it down a little bit. I'm just going to start by adding a very soft kind of gold color. So I'm going to use white, a lot of white, just a little bit of yellow ochre to start with, and then we'll add a little bit of burnt sienna to it as well. But it's very, very pale. You can tell it's really almost white. I want to keep this very light. And I'm just going to go side to side here. This is only going to show up. I've got lint on my canvas. I don't know how I did that. It's all linty. It's only going to show up like up underneath the tree, so this part right here in the sky, and then a little bit down here. So don't worry too much if you get streaks or anything like that. That's fine. Just keep it kind of horizontal with your brush strokes and you'll be good to go. Let's add a little tiny bit of this burnt sienna. And a little bit goes a very long way. And I'm just gonna quickly fill this in.
The first question's come in asking, would an acrylic pad be okay to work on?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, that would be fine. Watercolor paper would probably be fine. Wood, if you gessoed it, you could do this on. There's any number of, you know, different surfaces that'll accept acrylics. But yeah, canvas pad would work great. Acrylic pad. Those are actually made for acrylics, so there, and I might gesso it just because I personally don't like the texture of the acrylic pads. That's why I tend to use the mixed media ones. Just because they're a little bit waxy, it feels like. I don't know. The ones that I've used, at least. Yours might not be that way, but This is very subtle. I don't know if you can see this, but I'm adding just little tiny streaks of some of the burnt sienna in there and the yellow. So this part is very, very kind of subtle.
And what brush are you using there again?
This is a number one flat, Princeton 12, number 12 bright, but you can use whatever. These brushes are about $20, so I don't expect that you'd want to spend that much probably. I like them, but they you could even use a sponge brush for this, really. You know, it doesn't have to be a fancy brush because this is just kind of basic filling in.
And somebody wants to know, do you have a preference or a favorite kind of canvas that you like to work on?
When I'm doing things for, you know, like something really special, I do get the better canvases. But if I'm doing something, you know, that's just for practice or, you know, like for the videos, I've tended to start doing these on these canvas panels just because they're easier to store. And I have so many of these older videos. So that's the only reason I'm doing it on a canvas panel. If I was doing this to give to somebody, I would probably do it on a gallery wrapped and a canvas. And there's a brand, Dick Blick, is a art supply retailer online, and I get a lot of my canvases through them. And they're actually pretty cheap if you buy them in bulk, like 10 or more. So I just get those, and I get the 1.5-inch thick ones, and so the sides are kind of, you know, boxy, and the gallery wrap just means that the sides don't have staples. So that's all that means. But I do like the Dick Blick. I think they're called the Premier line. I don't have one on me or I'd show you, but I think they're all up in the cabinet there. Out of reach right now, but yeah. I actually did a, if you're on Facebook, I have a group called Thankful Art on Facebook, and I do Monday live chats in there, just like bonus chats, and I'm actually on camera. It's not my hands. And so I have to put on makeup, which, you know, I don't like. It's like every Monday I'm like, ah, oh, darn it, I got to put on makeup. All right. Got to do my hair. Jeez. What I do for you guys. But anyhow, I did talk about canvases and surfaces a couple weeks ago, probably one of my first ones. And you can go back and watch the recording of that. It's on in my video files in the group. So that's an option. And I showed all kinds of different pads and papers and canvases and brands and things that I've used to paint on. I need to do one for YouTube, actually. I'm kind of using my group as a guinea pig because I don't like to be on camera. So I'm getting comfortable with being on camera a little bit more, so I may start doing some for YouTube eventually if I get brave enough. That's the goal, at least. Okay, I think that's pretty good. So you kind of just see it's got a soft kind of glow to it. I did more yellow kind of in the middle section here and then did the darker kind of burnt siennas along the top and bottom. So I think that'll probably do it. And I'm going to pass this off to you, honey, to dry it for me really quick. Really quickly? Yes. And we'll go ahead and do something on Stickman. If you're first time to this, you will probably think, what the heck is going on here? Mark drew a Stickman for when we went to a museum a few months back, and he took a bunch of pictures with Stickman and brought them home. And so Stickman is well-traveled. And so every video that I do, I bring Stickman out and we add something that relates to whatever the video is we're doing. So last week we did the boho girl, so he got some flowers in his hair. And we did the pumpkin before that. This is a cactus, not a pickle. Drip trees, clouds. So I think we'll give him a little bit of a willow tree poking out the top here. Actually, let me see if I can make some green. with my blue and yellow ochre. We'll just give him some little willow branches kind of coming off the side here, hanging over his head. So this is just a little bit of fun that we like to do for our videos, and it kind of saves, gives us something to do while Mark's drying my canvases off for us, since that's not real exciting TV. So we'll just fill up this corner with a little weeping willow coming down here. There we go. We're running out of room. He's gonna be, that doesn't look too bad.
No.
Okay. Perfect. Mark's got some good drying skills. No, that's perfect. And it, you can see how it, oh, you got paint on you, poor thing.
Yeah, I'll post pictures later.
Okay. You can see how the paint dries a little bit darker too. So that's normal for acrylics. I'm just going to clean off my hands here so I don't get anything on it. And I'm going to sketch today with, you can use either a piece of chalk or this is a pastel pencil. So if you have one of those, that'll work as well. The pastel pencils don't erase as well, but even the colored chalk doesn't erase fully off of this canvas. So just be careful while you're drawing it. If you want to, you can, oh, bump my camera, sorry. If you want to, you could sketch this on paper and then transfer it later. So that's an option. I'm going to put my horizon line about a third of the way up the canvas. So I keep finding spots where there's wet paint on the sides there. No, I know. No, I'm going to just wipe it right now so I don't get it on my pencil. There we go. So I just usually measured with my hands, you know, just to kind of try to find the marks for a third there. So kind of try to space them out so that I kind of figure out where my third markers are, and my horizon line is going to go on the bottom third. And I'm going to try to, I really need a longer ruler for this. I need to get one of those T rulers that goes up against the canvas, but I'm going to use the edge of it to make sure that I get a nice straight line, because we want, when we're doing water, we want to make sure that the horizon line is completely straight. So I'm going to use a ruler for that this time. Just mark a line across for my lake horizon now. I don't know if you can see that, but it's there. And I'm not going to really sketch anything down at the bottom right now. I'm going to sketch the mountains at the top, and then we will put in our tree over the top of everything later. So the trees in the foreground will be the very last thing we do. So let's start out over here. Let me grab my reference photo so you can see. There is a mountain range that kind of extends up over underneath these trees. It's very faint. And then it comes down to about a third of the way here. It sort of ends. So that's going to be my mark where I want my mountain to sort of taper down to. So I'm going to just mark that a little bit. And then the tree line is going to be about an inch on this one. So I'm just going to kind of mark that. That's where my tree line is going to be. That's right at low, the lowest point there. And then our high point is going to be about right in the middle of our image, just maybe slightly above it. So if you find the middle mark of your canvas, that's going to be kind of the top of our mountain range. All right, and that kind of finding these marks in your drawings will help you draw to scale. So you don't need to know exactly how big everything is, as long as you can kind of refer to the sides of your image and figure out, you know, where they're placed relative to, you know, like this one on this third is the middle bump of this mountain where it comes down. You know, that kind of thing will help you while you're drawing So you could do this on any size canvas you want. Just, you know, if you're doing it on a huge canvas, you still find the middle and do your mountain range at the middle and still end it at the third. That makes sense. So
about how difficult would you rank this painting? Is it for beginners or intermediate?
This one's probably, I would say kind of maybe a fourth painting, something like that. I mean, it's not super difficult, but you probably need to have some brush control and some, you know, a little bit of drawing skill. But I will have a traceable for you for this. So if you can't draw, you can just go and find that traceable. It'll be on Pinterest, on Instagram, and on my Facebook group. So you notice I'm kind of tapering. I don't know if you can even see this. Let me zoom in. Well, let me zoom in just a little bit. Yeah, it doesn't look like you can see it at all. I'll draw a little bit darker. I like to draw it light because I, you know, in case I need to erase it, but I'll draw it darker for y'all so you can see what I'm doing. Okay, so I'm kind of going up, across, back down. I'm gonna wiggle it as I go. Back up a little bit. This is the main mountain range that's going to be visible because that's about the only part that's showing in those trees. So pay attention to that part. This part, you know, doesn't really matter all that much. Then it's just going to like gently taper down to our mark that we made over here. So we can just kind of do like that. And then there's another mountain range that's back that's really faint that's back in here. It goes like that. So we're going to do that one in, and it's almost as high as this one, but not quite. So we're not going to go quite as high. It'll go probably about here, and it starts about halfway up this mountain. So we're going to kind of curve it up and back down. And then it's just make sure that you don't go all the way down to your tree line because you want it to be visible above that tree line there. And then there's one more that's sort of right in between, and it is right in here, and it kind of comes flat, wiggles up a little bit, and then it sort of comes up higher. And I think I don't even know what I did with the end of it, but it's like right there. I can't even tell on my painting here where it went to because most of the tree is covering it. Okay, so we've got, yeah, you can even see it on this drawing, but it's right in here. It's this little, and it comes up like that. All right, now for our trees down here. They are just kind of basically a wiggly zigzag line. So just sort of some random zigzags. We're not going to do too much detail with our sketching. We just kind of want to get the basic height of it all. So we'll do the actual trees in later. There's a clump of them right in the middle right here that's sort of prominent. So we want to make sure we get that in. Let me pull this down so you can see both the. So that kind of comes up. There's a section that kind of comes down and goes back up.
They just noticed that your nails are naked.
They are naked today.
Yeah.
I'm giving my poor nails a rest. They are beat up. They're like chipping and. That nail polish, that gel stuff that I use is hard on them. So I have to use really strong nail polish to get them to stick with the paint. But that means that my poor nails get abused quite a lot. Okay, so it kind of dips down a little bit lower. If you notice right in here, maybe that's a little farther away. I don't know. But so the trees are just slightly lower right in that section, and then they kind of taper back up. Right, that's all the drawing that we're going to do, at least for this part. We'll do the tree later, but I'm going to set that aside, and we'll grab our canvas. this poor palette here again. I'm going to spray it because it's kind of starting to dry out. And I would suggest putting your paints away probably in between while you're sketching, just so that they don't dry out. Put them in your little plastic baggie to keep them fresh. I'm going to find a clean spot on that. I don't need my ruler right now, but I will need it later, so keep that handy. And I'm going to grab an angle brush. Now, you can use any kind of flat brush you want. I like to use the angle brush because I can kind of get in to little tight spots with the tip, but any kind of flat, medium-sized flat brush will work just fine. And I'm going to make a color with, and I'm going to go ahead and mix up quite a bit of it. So I'm going to mix my phthalo blue and my burnt sienna here, and it's going to make a dark blue-gray. And that's probably way too much burnt sienna for. That's making kind of a brown, which is not what I want, so I need a lot more phthalo blue in that. And I'll probably add even more. Now it's turning green, which is closer to what I want. Add just a little bit more phthalo blue to it. I normally don't mix up this much of a color, but we're going to be using this for all of our mountains and our trees. And so, put a little bit extra of that. And so I kind of want this base color to be the gradation that we use. So we're going to start out, it's going to be this color, and then it'll go lighter, 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 right? And we'll use it also in the water. So that's why I'm mixing up quite a bit of it. And we'll also use a little bit of it up in our trees, whatever's left over. Keep getting, I don't know what all this is coming from. It's probably coming from my notebook when I put it on top of it. It's getting lint on it. It's driving me crazy today. It's this white. Normally I can't see it because I'm using a color canvas. I can see everything on this white canvas here. Okay, so you kind of want to be a little bit more on the blue side, so probably maybe four parts blue to one part, or to three parts burnt sienna or something like that, closer to that ratio. That's getting pretty close, I think. Let me add a little bit of white to it. It is making a muck of my brush. So what I'm going to do here, since it got all spread out, is I'm going to scoop up. I'm going to use my brush like a shovel, and I'm just going to shovel all that paint out into the middle here, and then I'm just going to squeegee off the extra. And really, you should never get your paints this far up on a flat brush. I could have mixed this with another brush, because now I'm working all that paint down into my ferrule, which will be a pain in the butt to clean, but... Okay, let me grab a little bit of white and see what this color does. Oh yeah, that's lovely. Okay, very nice. So that made a nice turquoisey blue. That's pretty close to what I want. It's kind of a gray blue. I don't know, you could probably use ultramarine blue and burnt sienna for something similar. That'll be a little bit more of a gray than this one. Any of the, you could even use burnt umber and blue make pretty turquoisey blue colors. So, okay, I'm going to be cleaning out that brush really well because I got that paint all worked into the ferrule. Dry it off. All right, so we're going to work light to dark. And I'm going to take just a little bit of this color that I've mixed now. I'll just go ahead and use that spot over there. Scoop up some white. So you're going to need quite a bit of white. And just mix that in. I probably have way more of that color than I'm going to need, but I'd rather have a little bit more than I need than not enough. And I probably want it a little bit lighter than that, so I'm going to go ahead and do another one right next to it that's a little bit lighter. We'll just make this our middle value. That's pretty good. I want it very, very, very light. So go as light as you think it should go, and then maybe add a little bit more white because it's going to dry darker. See how light that is? It's almost close to our background color here. Maybe even a little bit more white. Okay. So I'm going to just use that and use the tip of my brush and fill in this mountain here. And I'm not going to go all the way down with the color. As I get down toward the bottom, I'm going to kind of just feather it out a little bit so that it's not as dark at the very bottom. Maybe leave just a little bit of that background color showing through in spots. And go over the top of your lines there so they disappear, your chalk lines. And you could use any color combination you want. So somebody was saying that they might want their tree to be pink. If you were going to do that, you would just, you could substitute pink, like quinacridone magenta, for your burnt sienna and mix it still with the phthalo blue and make a purple for the background mountains and then use the pink in the foreground tree. So that would work just the same. Any color combination, or you could even just use black and white if you wanted to. I'm just picking up a little bit of water and I'm just going to use the water to kind of blend down.
We have a request for a little bit of a zoom in.
Okay.
A little closer.
A little bit more?
Yeah.
Can we move it over? I'm trying to get to where I can have both showing on camera, but I don't know that that's possible. I just wanted to be able to see my notebook on camera, but I don't think I can get it in there. So if you want to, you could even add a little bit of white down here to your paint at the point where it meets the other hill. Doesn't have to be a drastic difference, but it'll help the illusion to have it a little bit lighter at that meeting place right there. I'm just going to add a little bit of white, and that seems to be working. So just filling that all the way across there, using that lightest blue color. This may even still be a little bit dark, but I think it'll work. Okay. Now we'll do this one here. This is our next closest. So we'll use that color that was the close cousin that was a little bit darker and put that in right there. The main thing is just to make sure that it's just dark enough to be able to tell the difference between the two. I'm not going to worry too much about my tree drawing here. I'm just going to kind of go down to that line.
We have a question asking, what is atmospheric perspective?
Jeez, I don't know. Good question. I would Google that.
Okay.
Atmospheric perspective.
Yeah, I'm not really sure either.
Not a clue. Not familiar with that. Sorry. It's been a long time since art school. It's not a term I use every day. I'm sure I probably learned that once upon a time. Did not stick, just like algebra. Okay, I'm going to grab a little bit of white. And I'm just going to add a little bit of white just at the bottom there.
somebody commented in that it's a bird's eye view.
Ah, okay.
Hey, sounds legit to me.
Yeah. Hey, I believe you.
Yep.
This probably would not be that then. This is more of a straight on perspective. Somebody was standing here by these trees and took this picture.
Well, of course, and then if it, the bird was sitting in the tree, that would still be the bird's eye perspective,
true.
Right?
True. Yeah. Could have been.
Somebody's commented, said that it's when color is gray and light and into the distance. So now we got two definitions. Not sure which one is right. I'm going to have to Google it, I think, myself.
We'll learn something. Well, basically, when you're doing, landscape, the colors farther away are going to lighten and they will lose saturation. So they'll be more gray than the colors closer to you. That's just a generalization, but that's kind of a basic rule to follow. All right, so got those two. Whoops, I kind of was off camera there, honey. You're supposed to tell me when I do that.
No, I'm watching it right
was
here.
It not on cam off camera? Okay, good. All right. All right, so we'll move down here.
You can zoom out a little bit if you want to.
No, that's all right. I think I can fit it in there.
Never mind. Just see the brush stroke, see what you were doing there.
Yeah, no, that's fine. Okay, so I'm going to grab a little bit more of this color. Yeah, I did make way more than I needed, but that's all right. Way more.
So next week's bear is going to be blue.
He is. He has blue.
Blue in him. Yeah, see?
Yeah, he has blue and brown. It's actually, what I did was use up this color palette on the bear. That's why I did him
so
yesterday.
On your test?
Yeah, because I had leftover paints. And so he does have some blues and things, blues and greens. It's very similar color palette. I just added a little bit of burnt umber to him.
Okay, they're saying that you can go ahead and zoom out.
Zoom out?
Zoom out a little bit. Yep.
Okay, I'll zoom out so you can see the drawing. How's that? That's better. Okay, so I've got one shade darker again for these mountains. Just filling it in. Really no fancy thing. I have different colors in my brush though, so you can see that it's sort of mottled a little bit, and that actually is good. Like I kind of like that it's not just a solid color. It's got a little bit of a variation. That's my preference. You can make yours a little bit more clean if you want. Probably need to add a little bit more of that, mix a little bit more of that color, because I'm going to need it down in the water. So light, darker, darkest. And it's still pretty light. It's not nearly as dark as this.
We have some character named DaBears10 joining us.
Hey, Nathan.
He claims that we're his mom and dad.
Yeah. Nathan, look what I made for you. That's next week's video, so. I'll have to give him that. I forgot his name. It's funny. It must have been subliminal. Subliminable. I called him the other day when he was live streaming gaming, so. To tell him about Jordan coming home. Our middle son is coming home. He's been in the Army, so he's been on deployment. So he's coming home in a couple weeks. We're real excited to get him back. He's been gone for about 6 months, so that'll be nice. And Nathan lives not too far away, so I'm hoping he'll come home. Hint, hint. No pressure. Home to see his brother. I miss both of my older boys. Like ditched the family at the same time. It was really sad. This year's been a lonely year. Poor Spencer's all by himself. Our last He's just, we make him come watch movies with us sometimes. Yeah. Like, come out of your room, come watch a movie. It's like, all right.
Yeah, but he's able to play online with his brothers, even though they're in, you know, different part of the state or across the world. They're able to still, you know, get on with each other and talk and play. Yeah. So it's really cool.
That is cool. Yeah, it's a long, a lot different from when you and I were dating. We had to send letters to each other. Okay, I'm taking a long time with this. I don't know why. This really doesn't take that long. I'm just talking and enjoying the process. So.
Yeah, this one's going to be a quick one, right?
This is going to be quick. I'm going to speed it up here. Just talking and thinking. And I do get into that little bit of a zen state and just kind of relax and relax into it. So. But I forget people are watching me live here, so I kind of need to speed it up. I'm just going a little bit over the top of my line there to just kind of hide it a little bit. Yeah, I had somebody comment, I talk too much, that I should paint more, talk less. See, it was not to be rude, but I hate your channel. That's how he started it. It was like, really? That's not rude at all. Like,
oh, it would be a pretty boring live show if you didn't talk.
That's kind of what I was thinking. I was like, yeah, you know, I don't know how I would. I guess I could have music on. You could just listen to music and watch me paint. It'd probably go a lot faster. I'm adding a little bit lighter color here at the trees line. And just, I'm not really being particular about my lines. I'm just kind of doing a random zigzag brush strokes going over the top of that. I'll go up over it. You want to come down lower than you think you need to with that, because you don't want because I said so. All right. So filling that in and grabbing some of that lighter color and doing that at the bottom here, blending it back up. All right. Yeah, this one really didn't take me very long when I did it. The example, it looks more difficult than it really is. It's not that hard. You can draw a wavy line and mix a few. It's a good practice for mixing colors, for sure, you know. So I think I want to bring this. Yeah, no, I think it's all right. All right, I'm going to leave it. All right, so now we get to start on our water. Fun. So I'm not going to use the same color as this. I'm going to use the sister color that was this medium one for all the places where this mountain is. So it's just like one shade lighter. So I'm going to grab that color.
Somebody asked, what is a complementary color?
Complementary color is opposite on the color wheel.
Okay.
So, whoops. Oh, goodness gracious. Look what I just did. I just totally jacked up my camera. Well, no, because I can't get it all in now. It's leaning really heavily. Sorry, guys. RoboCam. There we go. Okay. Don't touch it. Hopefully it won't fall. Here's blue, and the opposite, the complementary color would be orange. And so we're doing blue, and that's why when we mix that orangey brown, the burnt sienna, it creates this gray color, because adding your complementary will Let me see.
Where can you get a wheel like that?
I got this off of, oh, here we go. This is a better one. I got this off of Dick Blick, I think.
Okay.
So, and it shows you the complementary, split complementary. It shows you all these different color schemes and what happens if you mix other colors with it. It's pretty nifty. So it's a good reference. I don't refer to it all that often, but sometimes when I'm picking out color schemes, sometimes I do. Okay, so I'm going to clean out my brush because it's got a lot of paint all up in the... What?
Oh, just the sound of your brush in the water there.
Yeah. Well, using glass. I used to have a big Cool Whip tub. I don't know what I did with it.
Now we're using an old pickle jar, right?
Yeah, I'm using an old pickle jar now. Here's my poor beat up water jar.
We have a...
It's got all kinds of paints on all over it.
You got 109 likes.
Oh, boy. All right.
Yeah, people are going, what the heck's going on?
Doing the finger dance. It's about as good as it gets on my channel. You probably should be very glad for that, too, because you do not want to see me dance, that's for sure. Okay. So let's grab that color, right? So it's the one shade lighter. It's this color right here. I'm going to use that down in the water for this mountain. And basically, I just eyeballed it. Now, if you wanted to get, you know, scientific about it, you could measure, you know, to see how far away it is. But I kind of just tried to come straight down from the major high points and start out very lightly. And just do always horizontal strokes. So I'm looking at this and I'm wanting to be sure that I keep my brush strokes horizontal. So it kind of comes down a little bit here. So I'm going to come down this way. And I'm just going to angle it in, right? Try to mimic that as best we can. It doesn't have to be perfect. And if it gets a little bit too thick or not quite right, you can always go back over it with some of this lighter color, right? If you want to, you could even use your pencil and lightly sketch it just to give you a little bit more of a reference point. But I'm just going to fill in... with. And you notice that now the paint is kind of off my brush, so I'm just kind of, it's getting a little bit lighter. That's fine. I'll go back in and pick up a little bit more color, add a few more in places. With water, you kind of just want to make sure that it goes, there's a little bit of variation, light to dark. And I find that the reflections are often a little bit lighter. It's not always the case, but, you know, sometimes you have a very glassy surface that's perfectly reflective, and there wouldn't be necessarily all these ripples. It would almost look like a mirror image. There's, you know, there's some photographs. This one had, you know, some ripples in the water, so that's what I was trying to replicate. Okay, so now it's going down, right? So I'm getting closer here, and just kind of... You can even measure with your fingers and say, okay, it's about that far away, so it comes down to about right there. That's about that far away, so it might come up a little bit higher, and it's a little bit flattened out there. And, you know, it doesn't have to be, like, exactly perfect for it to get the effect. So it just has to be kind of close. So don't get too caught up in having to match. Just kind of, the water ripples will affect the image too and distort it. So, whoops, let me bring that down a little bit so you can see the original too. The main thing is, and the tendency is when you're doing water like this, is to do like that. Like you start out you start out straight, but you kind of do a little curve, and that'll look a little bit unnatural. So just try to really make sure that you're keeping your brush strokes straight. That will really help the illusion. All right, so here we've got another peak. So let's use my fingers here. This is my favorite little trick. I'm coming straight down in a straight line. And I'm going to match that up there.
You're going up the bottom.
Whoops, thank you.
Somebody asked, do you have a favorite kind of brush?
I do. These Robert Simmons Sapphire are some of my favorites. This one, the one I'm using now. They are a little bit softer, so they have some natural, I believe, they're Tacalon, which is synthetic fiber, and squirrel, maybe? I don't know. They've got some sort of natural fiber in there, I believe. So they're a synthetic natural mix. These ones are also my favorite. They're also by Robert Simmons, and they're the titanium line. So this is the sapphire lines. They have the blue handles with the gold, and then the titaniums are silver. And the titaniums are a little bit stiffer, bristled. So if you're doing a lot of heavy body acrylic paint work, you may want to go with the titanium line. And then they're pretty economical. They're about $4 to $5 a brush, which is about what you're going to pay for a decent brush. You know, one that's going to last you years and years and years.
And you have links to those down in the
description? I do. Well, some. I can't find all of them on Amazon, so I have links, I think, to some of the ones that I could find.
Where could they find those at? Like Michael's?
Michael's and Hobby Lobby, yeah. I don't think Hobby Lobby sells the titanium anymore in my, but yeah, I think that they all sell them, and you can get them online too, you know, at Dick Blick or any of those, probably Jerry's Artorama or any of those art supply stores. Okay, so here's coming dipping low, so I want to make sure that I hit that mark. It's right here. Just every now and then I'm just testing out my things here. This one came up a little bit higher. Okay. And I'm not worried too much about this shoreline because this is going to be very, very dark along that shoreline, but I do want a little bit of this color underneath. Because it'll show through here and there. So I'm just going to continue on down. I feel like this one is missing. It's like this part here. Maybe come out a little bit more. And you could even get the lines just by tapping this flat brush on its edge. You can get these straight lines. So if you were using a little bit bigger flat brush, you could do it that way. Okay. That's looking good. And then this one will be way up here. Come straight down from that, and it's going to be up here. So I'm going to angle this back down this way. That's my low point. Keep my lines horizontal. It kind of does a little mind trick on you because, you know, you're kind of doing the opposite. It's like Inception, if you remember that movie. It's like upside down. You have to kind of visualize everything upside down. So using your fingers kind of helps. And you notice I'm not filling it in solid, leaving a little bit of that background color showing through in places so that there's like ripples and reflected surfaces on the water. And then this is going to come down to about right there. So I'm hitting that mark pretty well. And that's good. Not too hard. Kind of once your brush kind of gets dry, you can kind of use that to skim and it'll kind of create some texture too. I did that. Okay, so that's that mountain, right? It's not too bad. Not too difficult. And now I'm going to just kind of feather out these edges just a little bit. Just softening them up. And I'm going to spray my canvas, my palette. And grab this lighter color. This was the lightest, this mountain color. And I'm going to use that to do some of this. Now, this is in my photograph, it was less distinct. You can see how, you know, it's very dark, right? And this reflection is very dark. This reflection is not quite so visible. So I want to keep my color very light, and I might even add a little bit of white to this to lighten it up even more. And I'm going to do this one. I'm coming straight down where that was, right in here. And angles down. You can barely see it. Might add a little bit more of that darker to it. There we go. Just for a few little streaks of a little bit darker. Most of this is going to be covered by your tree, but we want to get that in there. Make sure I'm getting kind of the basic distance there, right? Okay. Yeah, you can barely even see it over here. Let me grab a little bit of the darker. Just do a little bit, a couple of the streaks with the darker. All right, we're good. Now I'm going to clean my brush out really well. And I'm just going to soften up the transition between this color and this color, because it's kind of harsh right now. So I'm going to grab, and I don't have any of it left, so I'm going to mix up some white with my yellow oxide. Add a tiny touch of burnt sienna. Try to get it as close to that original background color as possible. It doesn't have to be the perfect match. And I'm just going to kind of come in here and add some lines, maybe just a tiny, tiny, tiny bit darker than my original background color, even. Having this white, the white is so opaque that it'll actually cover over some of that blue. If you have it watered down enough, it won't cover it completely, but it just gives it kind of a softness. A few more streaks. Add a few lines in. Just softening that up just a little bit. In our photograph, the water ripples get a little bit larger as they come down, and there's a little bit bigger gaps in between. So I'm just going to kind of add some of those in now that we've got our basic outline. Just kind of breaking up that perfect outline and making it a little bit more random. Doing okay, hon?
Oh, yeah.
Good. Who do we have in chat today?
We got Kathy and Rose and Gail, Mona, Lynn from Quebec, Christy, Michelle French. Got several.
That's awesome.
Yep.
That's awesome. We've got a really good group of people. I was getting to chat a little bit before the show. I got some very loyal folks that show up for every live show. It's awesome. Makes it more fun for us. Have some people watching with us live. But I know there's a lot of people that couldn't make the live shows and watch these replays. We're grateful for them too, for sure. A lot of them are watching football today. My friend Michelle came over the other day and she was like, I'd watch your live shows, but you always have them during the football games.
Now that's American football.
Yes, yes, not soccer.
Soccer, yeah.
Yeah, that's true. But yeah, I definitely didn't plan my live show schedule around football. I'm thinking about football in any way. Okay, so that's good. I think I'm going to add a little bit of this lighter blue in places too, just kind of break it up. Just don't want it so perfect, but I think that's getting closer to what I like. Okay, just softening it up. I think that's good. And I give it a few more little streaks in the water down here low, too. And I think that's pretty good. So let's go ahead and put in some of our pine trees here. This will be fun. Now you could switch to a smaller brush if you want to at this point. You could use a number 4 round or something like that. I think I'm going to stick with my angle brush, see how it does. I may have to switch to the smaller brush, but I think it'll just about fit in there. So I'm going to use this color that we have so much of. Now I'm going to wet it down one more time. I'm going to grab some of it and take it over here. Add just a teeny tiny bit of white to it. Keep it nice and dark. And this is going to be kind of the background of maybe a little bit lighter. So it's maybe one or two shades lighter than this color, which is almost black, right? And I'm going to, there we go, that's pretty good. Maybe even just a slight bit lighter. Because it's going to dry darker. I'm going to go ahead and fill in randomly. Using the tip of my brush, I'm just going to kind of tap along that edge. I'm going to zoom in so you can see this. Ooh, not that close. There we go. I'm going to tap in along that edge. I'm going to put my pine trees over the top of this. So right now I'm not really worried about that too much. I'm just sort of filling in my mountains like I did my mountains before. And I'm just going to put in random. Oops, don't go over your water line. I just did. If you can help it. We'll put it back in here in a minute. You could actually tape this off if you were really concerned about it, keeping it clean. Just go ahead and use that edge of my brush like a liner. Just whoops. Fill that all the way in up down to the horizon line. There, and just pull it up. You notice I am not being super careful. That's okay. We will, like I said, we'll clean up that line later. Just kind of make sure that you kind of can see where it should be. I'm going to fill in like there's some random bushes or something, just using that tip kind of pointing down, and scrub in some, just filling in that background area, and then the darker trees will go over the top of this. So you just want it light enough so that there's a little tiny bit of contrast when we put our trees over the top. Add a little bit of water so it's not so sticky. I'm really not trying to make any particular tree shapes. You can if you want to. But if you hold your brush this way, you could kind of tap in and it'll give you kind of a automatic pine tree shapes. So you could do that. I'm almost scrubbing. So we're at 1 hour, huh? So I was trying to keep this down to an hour. I never seem to do that at all. I don't know what the deal is. I could paint this at home in an hour. I don't know why it always takes me longer when I do these canvases.
Well, because you're by yourself.
That's true. Well, and these are smaller, so.
That's true. I have to do a speed painting one day.
Yeah. Yeah, I need to do a challenge and see how much I can get done in 15 minutes or something. Just filling that in. You can fast forward to the parts that you want to watch. You don't have to watch me do every single part. I kind of figured it out after the first.
So do we have to do this like a cooking show where you already have a dish
in the
oven?
I've thought about doing that. I've thought about having paintings like at different points of completion to kind of grab, hand off, start a section, then hand it off, you know. Okay, so that's good. And let's go ahead and put in our trees now. Zoom out just a little bit. Well, actually, I kind of want to keep it close. Okay, so now's where we get this really dark color. If you notice when I'm loading my brush, if you're a beginner, you never want to load it by pulling from the middle of a puddle of paint. You always want to just pull a little bit off to the side, and then I like to just kind of find a clean spot to sort of press it into my brush so that it makes a nice fine point for me. Now you can scoop up a little bit extra if you want it to be a little bit thicker with paint. In this case, I kind of do, so I'm going to push it to a point and then I'm just going to scoop just a little bit of extra paint on the edge of it. And I'm going to start, really it doesn't matter where I start, but there's kind of a trees right in here. So I'm just going to tap with the point up, make sure that these are vertical, and just do a couple of taps next to it. Tap, tapping, just like that. Not too worried about the bottom of it. We'll just pretend like it's fading down into here. We can go back in and touch it up if we want to. But I'm just going to kind of randomly add some trees. And really, they're about one brush width apart, right? They're not super thick, so don't worry too much about like creating a pine tree shape. You kind of just tap, press your brush down, and it'll kind of create the shape for you. And then you can kind of tap on either side of it a little bit if you want to widen it just slightly. But keep them pretty narrow. And just make sure that you're keeping your lines vertical. And I'm leaving a little bit of that lighter color underneath, and that gives it a little bit of depth too, just automatically, just by having that lighter color behind it. Okay, so here I'm gonna add a few. I need to be careful because my brush can't fit in there very well. And maybe just add a few like random bushes by tapping some dark areas with the tip of the brush. Just soften up those bottom edges so that they kind of blend down in to that original color. See how that happens? It already kind of has that little depth to it. This is going to look weird right here because it dips down low. So we're going to make sure we have a perfectly straight line on our horizon line later. All right, there's some more pine trees up in here. And honestly, doesn't really matter. I'm just kind of trying to make sure that I vary the height of them. And so I don't have like a repeating pattern. You know, that's the most important thing really with when you're doing paintings of nature, is they're very random. So repeating patterns look really odd. So you don't want to do all of your trees all the way across, all at the same height, because it'll make it look like it's a Christmas tree farm.
Okay. Somebody asked a question if you're using some type of a paint retarder.
Mm-hmm. If I am?
Yes,
you are. Oh, no, I'm not. No.
Just spraying it down with water?
Yeah, just keeping it wet with water. If you live in a dry climate, you might need a retarder, but I don't generally use retarders or anything like that. If you're using a retarder, you need to make sure that you're not using too much of it. I think that the percentage of retarder to paint is very low. I want to say it's like 13% or something like that. So you just don't want to overload your paint with that, or it becomes oily and doesn't stick properly and stuff. So, but I never have used retarders or a lot of gel mediums or things with my paints. I just mainly use water to create washes. You know, you don't want to use too much water. So using transparent colors gives you kind of a head start with that. Right? If you use a transparent paint, then when you make a wash, it'll automatically be a little bit easier to use. So you can see on the bottles, usually this one of course doesn't have it, neither does that one. No, I take that back, there it is. Okay, so some of them will show how transparent or opaque the paint is, and of course this carbon black is completely opaque. So this color actually has transparent in the title, so it's very transparent. I think something about the series numbers on some of these will tell you as well, but you can look that up online on the websites. Most of the newer colors, like the modern quinacridones and Hansa, I'm trying to think of the different pyrrole. Well, I'm not sure if pyrrole is transparent, but phthalo blue and phthalo green are both transparent colors. So that's why I like to use them a lot. Ultramarine blue is somewhat transparent. So you just have to kind of, you'll learn the more you paint with them, figure out which ones. I don't even know how I got on that when she was asking about retarders. It's not answering her question at all. Sorry. I guess I was getting on to just the general use of mediums in general. Because you can, you know, there's blending mediums, and I do use glazing mediums sometimes, so, but it doesn't necessarily slow down the drying time, glazing medium. So if you want to slow down the drying timer, retarder, and extenders, which you want to get. I'm just keeping on going down here, picking up a little bit more. I'm loading my brush somewhat thickly, but I'm not really, I'm still pressing it to a point so that it's got a good point for these trees, because I want them to have a nice crisp point. So and I'm sort of just drawing these in as I go. I'm really not following any my picture a whole lot at this point. I'm just kind of having fun with it. Putting in some happy trees. Bob Ross. I was always amazed. He never hardly, I don't know if I ever saw him sketch anything. He just kind of would just start out with the blank canvas and just go and just, like, I think I want a tree over here. And put one. It was like boom. He was the best. Okay, so that's good, I think. And nice and dark along my line there. It's very subtle because the colors are very close together, but you're still kind of getting a little bit of an illusion of depth there. Let me zoom out a little bit so you can see the whole thing. All right. I feel like this one could be a little bit taller. I'm going to make some of these trees a little bit taller because I'm looking at this one, and these are, you know, quite tall compared to these, and this canvas is bigger. So I think I want to make a couple of these just a little bit really, like, massive. Just to kind of give it a little bit of a focal point right there in the middle. That's better, I think. Maybe another one up in here, just to break up that line. Okay, that's better. All right, so now I'm gonna go back to this color for my water reflections, because that's the couple shades lighter, and I don't have any of it anymore, so I'm gonna mix some with my white. A little bit of water, and I'm gonna just brush most of this off of my brush so that I get a nice soft, there we go. Try to leave a little bit of your line visible there. So I'm going up to the line but not quite over it, and I'm just gonna go all the way down and add horizontal lines all the way down my waterline. Try not to go over the top of where these would be. I'm just kind of keeping them really narrow at this point. And then I'm going to work in my, I'm straightening up those boo-boos that I made along the way here, where I kind of went over my line too. This is where I'm really being careful. I don't want to go up over this line with it. So I'm just using the edge, flat edge of my brush to kind of draw in my line there. Any questions? We're good?
Nope, no questions.
Good. Well, yeah. That's good. Hopefully I'm explaining it okay then. All right, so now I'm going to do just like I did with the mountains and sort of pick out my most prominent features. So that one comes down to about right here. And I'm going to switch to a different brush. I'm going to get my spotter now, a small round brush or a liner, and add a little bit extra water to my paint. Just to make it a little bit easier to work with. When with a liner brush, you always want to have your paint a little bit soft, more fluid. Okay, so I'm gonna put those off to the side. All right, so where was I? Right here. We'll just start right there in the middle. So kind of measure. This is very scientific using my finger here, but just kind of come straight down from that tree. Make a dot. And then do some little tiny lines. I'm going to zoom in. Is that zooming? Is that focusing? It looks like it's out of focus.
I can't tell until it comes up.
Okay.
We're delayed.
Okay, sorry. There's another one right here that's a little bit lower. So. If I get it too dark, I can just tap it off with my finger a little bit. It's looking really unfocused in my camera.
Focused.
I don't know why. It's not focusing.
It's a little unfocused. It's not too.
Like it's not even focusing when I get up close. I must have it on manual something. I don't know. To figure that out. Maybe time for a new camera. So I'm just trying to match up these trees and do very light horizontal lines. See that? I feel like you can't see that because it's not focusing. I'll zoom out just a little bit. That's better. Okay, now it's in focus. Okay, so... And here again, if you want to, you could draw in. I kind of just eyeballed it, but if you're really concerned about it being perfect, you could draw in the opposite of what you're seeing there. Really not that. Not that perfect. That's about that far away. Here again, just keeping my lines horizontal. Leaving a little bit of my background color showing through. Trying not to curve my hand. Down. It's a little bit harder to keep it straight with these little liner brushes because they want to curve. So if you hold your brush kind of straight up and down, it can be easier to kind of draw your lines a little bit more straight. There's one right there. And really for the top of these trees, I'm just barely doing little dots. Just tiny little indications. That's a little bit farther up there. The thing with this is that if you get it close enough, your eye will kind of do the rest for you. So you don't have to get it just perfect. As long as you're close to the shape, your eye kind of fills it in and goes, oh, okay, that's the reflection. So that's kind of what we're trying to do here is just trick your eye into thinking that that's the reflection. All the way up to there. I feel like these are a little bit dark, so I might add a little bit of white to my paint. Just tapping it off will help too. it's gotten really dark, really quiet. You're not talking much today.
Well, people have commented that they like how you're doing the reflections that they've struggled in the past and trying to do something like that. So they're good. Really excited about trying this technique.
Trying it out. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah, this was, I decided to do the reflections because we'd had people in my Thankful Art group asking for more water tutorials and reflections and stuff. And so, just started looking at different images, and this was the one that really caught my eye. I just loved the whole look of it. Okay, I really need to speed this up because this, still have to do our tree and everything. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry. Okay, let's get this moving.
Talking and painting isn't as easy as it seems.
No. No, it's not a normal thing. Your brain doesn't want to function that way. It's kind of a right brain, left brain thing. All the words are over in the left side, and all the creative part is on the right side of your brain, so they don't want to talk to each other. You kind of want to use one side and not the other. That's why you kind of get spaced out sometimes when you're painting. And actually, that's why it's so therapeutic, though, too, I think, because it kind of shuts down all of the other thoughts in your head and just kind of lets you focus on something relaxing and all that stress and other things, thoughts and things kind of disappear. Oops, I was off camera there a little bit. Sorry.
A question came in asking if you painted the lines crooked mm-hmm. instead of straight, would that indicate the water being more agitated or wavy?
Mm-mm.
No?
No, because even far away, they're going to straighten out. Yeah. So even if you're... if your water is more agitated, you're just going to see more straight white caps lines. So, you know, a still lake is going to have very few lines at all. It'll have more of a full reflection. And then very agitated, I'm going back in with my lighter color now and just softening up, just like we did over here, just softening up the edges and adding a little bit of other color in there. No, because it's so far away, you're not seeing the waviness of it. You're only seeing the parts that are sticking up over the wave in front of it, which is also going to be straight. I don't know if that makes sense, but
yeah, it makes sense that if it's calm, it's like a piece of glass. So then you would just be a full solid shade.
Right.
And
right.
If it's wavy, then you'll see the breakup.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Right. But the way the angle of it, the way the water works is that, you know, it's just, if you look at any pictures of water, pretty much they're all going to be. Now, the close-up waves could be curved, you know, and will be curved. The ones that are closer to you, you can kind of add some of that curviness. But all of these that are really far away, the only part that your eye is seeing is the flat lines. Okay, let's do our trees here. Do, do, do. Do, do, do. This is where I'd crank up the music because this is kind of tedious. So you kind of need your... to music to kind of help it along. Yeah, this part, you just kind of have to be patient with it. It's a little bit, like I said, a little bit tedious, but it's worth it if you take your time and just kind of, but like I said, it's not really all that hard. You can use your fingers and measure, and you can come straight down and make a dot and then just kind of fill it in wider as you get down closer to the shoreline. So...
a reminder to everybody who's part of Angela's Thankful Art Facebook group, we are still taking name for the unicorn contest there. for Francisco's girlfriend.
Yeah.
So it's not too late to submit a name.
Let me see if I can get her down. There she is in all her glory. Francisco is my... I'll get him. I can reach him. Francisco is my alpaca. Whoop, let me move, zoom it out. He's my alpaca. He's real alpaca, and we have to keep him up high because the cats will get to him. They think he's awesome, and he's very dapper. He's got, you know, he's got his...
They'll get paint on him.
No, I won't. He's got, like, a nice little saddle there and everything. So I've had him for about 3 years. He's been a bachelor, and I found this little Missy on sale and thought she would make the perfect girlfriend. And she has a tramp stamp, so he's hopeful. So we're naming her. We're having a contest in my... It's not really a contest. We're just having some silliness to name her. We've gotten some good names. Rainbow, with a rain, R-E-A-I-G-H-N, or whatever. B-O-B-E-A-U. That's pretty cute. So, yeah, we do. Sometimes, you know, I do requests for, you know, like what you want to see painted. Like a couple weeks ago, well, about last month, I guess it's been now, I did seascape, or not sea creatures. So it was like a, I feel like that one needs to be a little bit taller. It was sea creatures, and so I did a poll to find out what people wanted me to paint and that kind of thing. So every now and then I'll do some sort of fun poll just to keep things fun, and then you can go in there and show me what you've painted from my tutorials too. And I can, there's a lot of really nice people in there that I've gotten to meet. They're very sweet. So it's just a way for me to connect with the people who are actually using my videos and watching. It's awesome. Okay, so keeping on going here. I feel like I didn't take this long, but I'm trying to be more careful for y'all so that you get the full awesomeness.
Well, I think that it helps people know how long to expect to do it themselves, you know, how much time to carve out. You know, yeah. We can do it in one sitting or...
Right.
Do it over a couple of days or something like that.
Yeah, and I'm also paying attention to this in-between section so that I'm getting that high enough there in between where those larger trees are. Yeah, I kind of really pretty much filled in this whole bottom section when I did my example one. I didn't leave as many little lines, but I felt like this was a little bit better way of doing it, more accurate, maybe. But it just takes a little bit longer. Just even just some little dots. All you need. It's looking good. I think we're getting the general shape of it. Almost done here. Then we can do our tree on top. feel like this one should be taller. Maybe just a little bit. Right. I'm getting very quiet. I'm really concentrating here. Sorry. Try and go faster. What are you typing over there, hon?
Oh, just talking about length of videos and stuff like that. Mm. Nothing that exciting.
Let's hear tap, 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 type, type.
Yeah, sorry.
It's all right.
I'll try to type quieter.
Oh, yeah. No. Yeah. As he goes back to typing. I'm just using my finger to tap off a little bit. A little bit of that. Almost done. Most of this is going to be covered up when we do our trees, but we still want to get it right just in case some of it shows. So. Okay, grabbing some of the white. Almost out of white here. Add a little bit of the lighter color just to soften up that transition and give it a little bit of a reflective quality. Really kind of just dry brushing, letting it catch the canvas texture. Add just a little bit of streakiness over the top and softening up. There we go. All right. So that's about it. I think that's pretty good. And I'm going to just go back in and clean up my horizon line. This is where you can use your ruler if you want to. Lay that down over the paint that's already dry. Right on that line. Make sure it's nice and straight. Just above it. Whoop. Then I'm going to use my white. And just whoop, okay, make sure you don't have any water on it. And just lightly dry brush right along that line. You can use that ruler as your guide. And I'm not doing it a solid line, so I'm kind of leaving a little bit of the undercolor showing through in places. So just kind of going back and forth, scrubbing a little bit of white along that line, and letting that ruler kind of help you get it straight, keep it straight. Let's see how that's doing. See? I'm just going to go back in. Touch it up here. in there. How are we doing for time? We're already at 1.5 hours. Okay. Well, this will be a 2-hour lesson, I have a feeling. Okay, that's good. So we kind of have a nice bright line right along the horizon line, and you can see on here how it kind of is not, gets darker in some places and than others. So, let us grab my pencil again. And I've got all this space up here to work with, and our section down at the bottom is very, very narrow. So the part that is rocks and bushes is very small. So I'm just going to kind of indicate a few rocks, some random shapes. The tree starts right at that third. So if you measure our thirds on our canvas here, it's going to start right here. So I'm going to, can they see this? Okay, I guess I'm going to have to do it a little bit darker. Again. Bush, 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 right there, and then out. So it's very, very low along here. Hope they can see that. Then our tree comes up, and about halfway up, it starts to turn up. So I'm going to go ahead and keep it narrow. And about right here, I'm going to start curving out this branch and angling it up this way. And then it's going to, oh, about the same distance there. So it comes out about like that. Then it's going to turn and come back this way a little bit. And then turn again right here and angle out like that. This one is going to come out this way, right at that point where it was. There's kind of a soft curve there. This is going to angle out kind of up toward the corner. And this is actually a bit longer before it goes like that. Comes out. So just about the point where it hits the top of that mountain there, it curves back this way. So it kind of meanders a while in that general direction before it curves back that direction. And it starts to narrow a little bit as it gets toward the top. So all trees kind of do that, just about, unless you're, I think the banyan trees have thicker up there. I don't know, they're kind of an odd tree.
What kind of pencil are you using?
This is just a pastel pencil, because I found that it did erase okay. You could use chalk if you don't have a pastel pencil, but it did come off pretty easily like chalk. So I feel like this needs to be a little higher. So I'm going to make this branch a little thicker and bring that Y up there a little bit. There we go. I always like to use something that'll erase, because chances are you're going to want to make some adjustments when you're drawing, especially if you're drawing straight onto your canvas. And pencil will show through your paint. So I don't hardly ever use pencil on a canvas. Right. So let's now this branch is going to angle up and kind of out, sort of toward this point right here. It kind of changes direction and then curves back that way and goes off canvas. Oops, I'm not showing it. Sorry. This one curves back this way. The main thing with trees is you're always wanting to make these Y shapes at junctions, right? And narrow them as they go up and away from you. So that'll help keep them looking more natural. This one almost goes straight up there. This one crosses over and keeps going up this way. It's making a terrible chalkboard noise. Sorry. This one comes from here, curves out and fills that empty space there. There's another branch here. And then your willow tree is coming in from the side, so it's coming in and curving down there, and then again right here, and covering over the mount just a little bit. So I'm not going to indicate a whole lot of that. You're not really seeing this at all, are you?
It's okay. Do you use watercolor pencils?
I do. Yeah, and you can use watercolor pencils instead for this.
But you, excuse me, do you use them?
Not usually when I sketch, because I find that watercolor pencils don't erase as easily. So okay. I am all about the easy erasing. So.
And do you have any special recommendations for what kind of watercolor pencils or brand or anything like that?
I like Derwent pencils. That's my, but they're an ink. They're not actually a watercolor. They're called ink tents. But they are the most vibrant ones that I've used as far as watercolor pencils go. So but yeah, you could use those. I feel like you can't see this at all. I'm sorry. I'm just going to try to hurry up and draw this out. Angle it up this way. It's going all the way up to the top of the canvas, so there's another junction here that kind of just notice that I'm making these more narrow as they get toward the top of the tree. And there's some branches that kind of curve down. There's branches that curve this way that are on the back side of the tree. They're curving down like that. All right, we're almost done with the tree portion here. Let's just get a few random branches in here to kind of fill in. So I don't know what kind of tree this is. The reference photo said ginkgo, so it might be ginkgo tree. And then the willows are actually kind of off to the side here. And these are kind of filling in this whole area here. And I'm not going to really sketch them in too much. But you notice that they kind of do this angular thing. So they sort of angle up this way, up, and meet up with that tree. So just kind of do that when you're, I kind of just gave myself some boundaries. And the willow has a couple of branches that come out this way and angle down. The willow branches will kind of sag, I guess, for lack of a better word. They're kind of droopy. So it starts here and it's going to angle out like that. They kind of curve out. Okay, that's good enough because we're not going to do a whole lot of that. So let's grab. I'm going to start out with my angle brush again, and I'm going to go ahead and grab black this time. And I'm going to use a little bit of that dark color that we mixed up and add it to my black. And just fill in the bottom of my canvas. This whole area is just pretty much black. And I know on the picture it has some light to it, but I wanted to keep it in silhouette, so I made an artistic choice and just went with black. There is a little bit of variation in the tree itself. I added a little bit more of the lighter colors in the tree, but down here I kept it pretty dark. And then with these bushes, don't get too high with your base coat because we're going to stipple in some greenery. So keep it low. You can just tap with the tip of your brush if you want to make it a little bit fuzzy along that edge there where all these bushes are happening. That in. Same thing with this bush over here. Just tap, tap, tap with your brush to kind of give it fuzzy edges and then fill in the rest. Okay. Good. I'm going to switch over to my number 4 round. So just give me a little bit more control. Grab a good amount of that and get some of my black. I'll wet that down so that I have a nice fluid paint to work with my round. Twist it to a point, and then we're going to fill in our tree. And I'm just holding it kind of like a pencil, and just when I get to the edges, you can kind of wiggle it a little bit, or not wiggle it, but necessarily, but kind of tap it. Slightly. Don't lift it from the canvas, but just vary the pressure on your brush. It may happen naturally if you have a little bit of a shaky hand. That'll give it a little bit of like a texture to the edge of the tree bark. You notice it's got kind of an imperfect line. There's a little bit nubs and things that are happening. So just by altering the pressure on your brush, you can kind of create that. Hold it very lightly as you pull down. Just trying to make sure that I don't get any areas up here that are a lot thicker than down here, because this down is closer to the trunk, it's going to be thicker. So I've already said that like three times, but most of the trees that I see people have problems with are because of that. Or they get the tree trunk wide, really wide. And when you're learning how to paint, sometimes that's, you know, the more you mess with it, the wider your branches will get. With this, the only part of that tree that's really going to show is this bottom part. I just stuck my thumb in it. Is this bottom section, right? So this is the part where you want to, you know, take your time with. But your branches up here, they can be a little bit imperfect because most of it's going to be covered up with a lot of the foliage. You know, you'll see still see them a little bit, but you can just go a little bit thicker with your foliage if you want to cover up a little bit of a boo-boo. Or you could always go back in with your sky color. With acrylics as well, you can also erase them if you catch them right while they're wet. So if you go outside your lines a little bit, you can use a wet paper towel to wipe off a mistake before it dries. Just make sure that your background's dry if you're doing that. If your background is not dry, then you're going to lift off the background and the up top coat. And I have done that. Okay. So now when I'm getting up here to these narrower branches, I'm really barely touching the tip of my brush and just letting it drag. If you want to at this point, you can switch to a thinner brush if that gives you a little bit more control. So, where you have these transitions between the branches, you can kind of add a little bit of a softness there. This tree's a little bit more angular than some others, so it's got some interesting shapes to it. So there, I got that line a little bit thick. I'm just going to go with a wet cloth and just wipe that off. It should come right off for you. Might have to rub at it a little bit, but keep adding water and it'll come right off. See? And then you can let that dry before you go back in and put your other line in. What are you laughing at over there?
I request to keep the plate off to the side when you're picking up paint.
Oh, somebody requested that?
Yeah.
Okay.
They're trying to paint with you.
Oh, so they can't see. Am I keeping it in front of the... Okay, sorry. Okay, I'll put it down so that I don't, if I put it on this side, I won't. Let me move my water. Just filling in these branches. don't worry too much if you don't use all of the go over your lines perfectly that you drew. I just use those as a guide. I don't like have to have them the same. So you can go back in after your painting is finished and erase any lines that are still showing. Wow, somebody's painting this with me. That's brave. I've only done that once. I painted with somebody, with Cinnamon when she was doing hers, and she painted with me on our first collaboration last winter, and that was so hard. It was so hard to watch and paint live, like real time. Just filling in these branches with black here. I feel like there's a lot of quiet in this painting. A lot of thinking.
On your part or our part?
Your part.
Yeah. Well, people are kind of lamenting that there's a lonely tree on this side of the water. All his friends are on the other side.
He's got the willows to keep him company. He's got these willow trees over here. Canvas is moving on me. These ones are curving down. There's a little bit showing right there. Let me see, there's another branch. Getting close here. Almost done with this part. With this, you always kind of want to have your brush tilted slightly towards the direction it's going, because if you do it this direction and tilt this way and try to push it, the bristles will come apart on you. So you always kind of want to have your brush angled up so you can turn your canvas if you need to make it a little bit easier to keep your hand in the right position. If you're having a hard time making a straight line, that might be part of the problem.
We got a question. If you have a tip on how to use a lighter touch when you're doing this.
I mean, honestly, a lot of that has to do with practice. So, but I feel like holding it really close to the ferrule helps. Also, turning your canvas can help. So turning it so that you're pulling your brush in the direction that would be natural for you to write. So, you know, if I'm right-handed and I write in this direction, then pulling my line in that direction is going to be naturally easier for me. I'll have a little bit more control over the pressure that I'm using. Sometimes supporting your hand can be helpful. I usually just kind of gently rest my hand on my canvas, but I feel like, you know, if you just barely touch it to the canvas, if you have your brush loaded properly with enough paint and you twist it to a good point, it should do most of the work for you. All you have to do is barely touch it to the canvas and it should give you a decent line. So, I don't know if that helps, but a lot of it just has to do with trial and error and practice, practice, practice. Do another one down here. I think we're about good. Just adding a few more little random ones just so that we have a place to know where to put our foliage. Fill in some of these empty spots here. Okay, that's good enough, I think. And then with our willow, we've got just a few little very thin lines coming up and curving down.
Yeah, I'm able to just give people answers now, like a professional painter, having heard your tips before, you know, like how to steady your hand, you know, make a fist with the other hand and rest your arm on there.
That's so, right. Yep.
Yep. Might start my own channel here. I don't know. We'll see.
Don't need me anymore? You're going to branch out on your own? Okay. So that's good for the willow. This one over here, I didn't have any of the branches showing, I don't think. So those will just kind of do naturally. Okay. We're almost done. Foliage goes pretty fast.
So time to take it home, huh?
Almost time to take it home.
All right.
Okay, so I've got two brushes that I'm going to use. I'm going to use the fan brush for the willow tree part. Because those are, you know, kind of straight lines, and I'm just going to hold it on its end. A stiffer bristled fan brush is the best. For the foliage, you can use any number of different brushes, and I kind of pulled out some different ones to show you. This one's a very small one that's kind of been ruined, so it's got fuzzy edges. This is a little bit larger flat that's also been ruined, so don't throw out your ruined brushes. You can use them for these kind of things. This is a stiff bristled, like hog hair round. This one is a deerfoot stippler, and you've probably seen me use that before on trees. It's one of my favorite foliage ones, and this one is called a foliage angular. It's a shui brush, and it's one of my favorites for bigger trees and things like this. So and then it, if all else fails, you can always use your sponge for this tree, especially because it's quite large, so a sponge would work just fine. I'm going to use this brush. You can also, I use this one for my example, but this painting is a little bit bigger, so I'm going to use my bigger angle brush, but you could do the same thing with the smaller brushes. I'm going to start out by, and I'm keeping this brush dry. I'm going to grab a little bit of both my black color and my pre-mixed color and just load it on the tip. If you get too much, you can wipe it off. But any of these foliage type things, you're pretty much going to want to go with a dry brush. And I just like to load the tip so that a little bit thicker on the tip so that I have a little bit more control. This one's angled. The deerfoot stippler is also angled, so you'd also load it on the tip. If you did your sponge, you'd just load a tiny little bit of it just to give you some control. And I'm going to just barely tap. See how that fuzziness just gives you kind of this natural tree-like thing going on? This is our dark color, so I'm going to use it kind of sparingly. And just kind of soften up the transition between the branches. Now, most of this area up here is going to be completely filled in. So I'm just going to tap lightly. If you get some thicker areas, just pick up. You should barely be tapping this. And you notice I'm not filling it in. I'm not filling in all of my available space. Just keeping it very light and airy. I can always go back and do more, but I, you know, you can't put back in your sky if you cover it. So, I mean, I guess you could put in a little bit of the sky color, tap it in, but then you'd have to paint your tree trunks again and all that kind of thing. So you don't want to have to do that. It's just a lot easier to go light. Lightly load your brush carefully, not too thickly. We're going to add a couple more colors to this, so really this whole area here is pretty full with color. You may have to put out fresh black paint if it's getting dry by now. Mine's starting to get a little sticky, so I think I'll make it work, but it's getting a little bit dry. Okay, one other thing you don't want to do is go straight along your tree trunk and line your tree trunk all the way up. You want to kind of go back and forth over it so that you have some randomness. The tapping should go over the top in places, but don't use that as like your guide to cover over completely. So I think that looks pretty good. Looking pretty decent. All right, so now I'm going to grab a little bit of white and mix my teal color. Might even grab a little bit more of my phthalo blue to give it a little bit more of a dark blue. That's good. And so we're going to go back over some of these areas with this color. I'm just going to add a tiny bit of water because it feels like my paint's getting really sticky. It's not cooperating very well. Add just a tiny bit of water to it.
Your fans want to know if you ever paint with watercolors.
I do sometimes, but acrylics are definitely my go-to. I mean, I'm not as knowledgeable with watercolors. I just haven't used them enough to know all the little tricks. I mean, I've done them a little bit, but not enough to probably teach it. So that's why you don't see a lot of teaching with watercolor from me, because I don't feel like I'm proficient enough to know how to help you do it right. I need to still work on that so I can. There's some awesome watercolor teachers out there on YouTube for sure. So I need to watch and do some lessons. Learn, then I can do it for you. But I've been doing acrylics pretty steadily for so many years, and just I can get kind of similar watercolor type looks, just turning my brush and using the tip of it now. Acrylics, you can do almost what you do with a watercolor, but also one of the things about watercolor that I didn't like, when I tried it, or have you done it before, is just that it's pretty unforgiving. You kind of have to get it right. the first time, there's really not a lot of, you know, acrylics are a little bit more forgiving since you can paint over the top of them. With acrylics, you go dark and then add your highlights. With watercolors, you go light to dark. So it's the exact opposite application of acrylics. So it just feels foreign to me. Okay, I'm grabbing that teal color. I feel like I need it nice and dark in a couple places. So now I'm going to go back in and really darken up a few areas. Add a little bit of depth. Okay, now I'm going to switch over and grab my number 4 round. Grab the black. And I'm just going to, on some of these outer areas, actually I think I want to add a little bit of white and blue to make a little bit of softer color. Don't want it so in your face. There we go. Okay. I'm just going to make some little leaves along just in a few areas. So just kind of setting my brush down and creating a few little leaf shapes. Just tapping, pulling some random shapes right along the edge of that tree. It just kind of helps sell the whole look of it. Add them in a couple places wherever you feel like you've got spot for them. But especially like where you've got these open areas at the edge of the tree. And they're kind of angled down and out. So do a few out here. Just random. Don't get too caught up in the details on these. Just keep them random. Do some in the middle to kind of soften it up so it looks like there's some in some of these open spots. I'm grabbing the black now and really adding some nice dark ones up through my tree, pressing down even a little bit harder. Okay, we're good. Oh my gosh, we're over 2 hours. Sorry. Okay, that's good. We'll call it good on that tree. I'm going to use some of that color down here. Tap in some highlights on our rocks. Maybe put a little bit on our tree. And along that edge. That's that kind of blue color. All right, let me grab my fan brush. I'm going to wet it down just a little bit and grab that turquoise and black, a little bit of blue, grab some of the white, so I have a little bit of that on my brush too. Don't overblend it so it's got some streaks in it. And I'm going to curve down on this side, and I'm just tapping. Once I get to this horizontal, I come straight down with it. So these outer edges can be kind of curved a little bit, like it's falling over the edge. And then once it's made its turn, you want to keep those lines vertical. Leave a little space. And doing a little bit of white streakiness in with your colors will help it, so you don't have to go back in and add any highlights or anything. It's already in there. You could also do that with your tree if you wanted to save time. Okay, this side doesn't come down all that far, so I'm just going to kind of cover over like that. And then this side over here, there's quite a bit of it peeking through. So it's kind of coming over. And this whole area up here is pretty much straight up and down, so kind of fill that in. These branches here will have the color coming down. I kind of put that tree over the top of them a little bit more than I probably should have. So some of those will curve at the top, but most of them are just going to read as coming straight down on this side.
Somebody asked, what if they don't have a fan brush? What could they use instead?
You could use your number four round and just do, like, you know, long tapping motions with it. Probably a brush like one of these smaller ones like this might work. Let me try it and see how it looks. You could get something similar with that. It might, and then, you know, just on the very tips, you could add use the tip of a smaller brush, like a liner brush or something, to do these really fine points at the tip of the willow tree. But remember, this kind of angled down, so it's kind of came over and angled all the way down to right about here. And then it didn't quite cover all the way to this bush, so there's leave a little bit of breathing room.
What brand of fan brush is that?
This one's a low Cornell, I think. Yeah. Any stiff bristled hog bristled brush would be fine, though. Fan brush.
And there's a link to a fan brush in your description below.
Yes, there is.
Yep.
Yeah, I found one. I don't think it's a low Cornell, but it's a similar. Well, I did mix up about the perfect amount of that color, so it turned out well in the end. Okay, so this I'm just going straight down, all the way down, making lines. And I'm not doing a full line all the way down, so I don't want to make it look like stripes, right? So I'm kind of tapping and moving my brush up and down and side to side a little bit so that it keeps a little bit of its randomness. That way it doesn't make it look like we're, you know, painting stripes. Leaving a lot of this background color showing, though. And then every now and then I'll kind of find one that I want to make a little bit darker and kind of define a little bit more. But for the most part, I'm just sort of doing these random lines, all keeping them horizontal. Pretty easy. Fan brush does all the work for you, so it kind of keeps it easy. I'm barely touching down with the fan brush. I've got it loaded nice and thick with paint, so barely have to touch it down. We're almost done. I promise the bear next week is not going to be nearly this long. I swear to you. Every week I think, okay, I'm going to do one that's really short. Like, this will be an hour tops.
How long did it take you to do the bear?
The
sample?
Bear took me like 15 minutes, so I know he's going to be.
Okay, so we're about an hour and a half then.
Could be. Very well could be. Oops, I just bumped the camera. Sorry. So, and see how I'm kind of leaving some of these, pockets of space along the edges. It's really important to kind of give it that look of weeping and airiness that these trees have. So, and this is actually pretty dark back here, so it's kind of disappearing that tree altogether right there. I'm going to grab a little bit more white and maybe add a little bit of white highlights in some of the places right over that so that you can see where the tree limbs are. And then on mine, I took my spotter and I used it right along the edge. I'm going to zoom in. I used it right along the tips and did some little tiny, little tiny leaves right at the end. They kind of fan out a little bit from the outside edges of the willow tree. So I wanted to kind of give a little bit more detail to the very tips of those branches. So just kind of setting it down and pulling in toward the center. Just adds a little extra realism to it. You don't have to do this. It's just kind of adding a little bit extra detail to it.
We had a request if you would be able to do a another leaf with the fan brush, maybe on a blank piece of paper, just so they can see the technique again.
Another what leaf? The willow tree leaf?
Yeah, using the fan, but do it on like a blank piece of paper so they can see it.
All right. Okay, so let me zoom out a little bit, and there's our finished painting. I feel like the water probably could take a little bit more. I might do a little bit more streakiness of the with the, some of the blue and randomly. I'm not going to do it today, though. We're done. So I'm not going to do it on my sketchbook. I'll do it on the back side of this guy. I guess. Let me see if I can find a blank piece of paper. There we go. So we wanted to see the fan brush again, doing the willow tree leaves.
Yeah.
Just one branch or like multiple?
They didn't really specify.
Okay, well, I'll do a couple of them.
Okay.
Side by side here. So load your brush thick enough with paint so that it just comes right off by tapping it lightly. You should not have to press down hard for the paint to come off. If you do press down hard on it, it'll come off in a blob. So you're barely tapping to get that really soft look. And zoom way in here. So here's my willow branch, right? I'm going to curve it along the willow branch, just tapping very lightly. And then coming down from it, I'm going to do some little streamers. As they fall, as they come off of that branch, they may curve a little bit, but then they're going to come straight down. So I'm just barely touching, moving down. Now when I'm doing like covering a whole page with it, I am doing, you know, tap, 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 leaving a little bit of space in between, tapping a little bit longer on this one, maybe a little shorter there, a little shorter there, and stacking them, but not filling in all my white spaces. The leaving those gaps is what's really going to help give your eye that weeping willow feel. And then along the edges here, like this is almost a perfect little curve. So I wouldn't want that. I'd probably want to have some of them coming down longer, some shorter, and leaving a little bit of space.
So there's a lot of paint on the brush, kind of like one of those like old quill pens where it just kind of runs off. You don't have to push very hard.
Right, yeah, there's a ton of paint on here, so it's just barely touching. And, you know, if I press it down really hard, I'm going to get that. You know, I don't want it to be a solid line. I want to see the individual bristles kind of touching. So, and the reason that I like the stiff bristle brushes more than the fan brushes that are the softer bristles, is because they clump together. The bristles, the fibers of the brush tend to clump together. And so you do get almost a perfect line when you tap with them instead of getting this random randomness. So hope that helps. All right. Thank you all so much for watching this another marathon painting here for Saturday. I promise you next week we will be a lot shorter when we do our bear with glasses. You don't have to do him with glasses. We're going to do the glasses at the very end. So if you want a more just a realistic bear without his silly glasses, you can do him that way too. But he should be a lot of fun and very easy. Simple palette and limited brushes that you'll need for him. So I'm looking forward to that one. And I will see you next time. Be sure to subscribe. Yep, thanks for watching. And I will see you next Saturday at 2 p.m. right here, same bat channel.
Same bat time.
That's right. Thanks so much, guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye.